Along the coastline of Western Europe lie the remains of one of the largest construction projects of the 20th century.
Hitler says, I want to build an Atlantic wall. I want defenses all the way up the coast.
40 million tons of concrete designed to stop the D-Day invasion of Nazi Europe.
15,000 bunkers along a coastline stretching 3,000 miles.
Built in just 4 years, a vast network of indestructible bunkers, deadly minefields, and impenetrable artillery positions.
It's all separate pieces working together to make this going like a monster, really.
It is the most gigantic fortifications that were ever built in history.
This is the story of Hitler's Atlantic Wall. The biggest construction projects of World War II, ordered by Hitler to secure world domination. Now they survive as dark reminders of the Führer's fanatical military ambition. These are the secrets of the Nazi megastructures.
Sixth
of June, 1944. The D-Day invasion has begun. In Normandy, 1,500 Germans face an Allied force over 150,000 strong. Soldiers such as teenager Franz Kochel are relying on their bunkers to keep them alive. Bunkers that form an extraordinary 5,000-kilometer fortification known as the Atlantic Wall. Nazis built this megastructure along Europe's west coast to protect Hitler's empire from an Allied invasion. Dr. Peter Lieb, former German army officer and war studies expert, has studied the wall's construction.
There were bunkers all over France along the coastline, in Belgium, in the Netherlands. It is the most gigantic fortifications that were ever built in history.
The origins of the wall can be traced back to 1942. Hitler's invasion of Russia has stalled, and over 1 million of his best soldiers are heavily engaged with Soviet forces. And then, in December, Hitler's worst fear becomes a reality. America joins the war.
Hitler knew this was coming, and he knows it's very bad news. Not only is he heavily engaged in Russia to the east, he now knows that Britain has got a very strong ally to the west in the form of the USA.
With the addition of hundreds of thousands of US troops and guns to help them, the British now pose a serious threat to Hitler's conquests in France, Belgium, Holland, and Norway. To protect his Atlantic coastline, Hitler must take defensive measures.
And so he puts out his famous Directive 40, which is basically rattling the cage and saying, enough, we need to get our act together. And in a series of bullet points, he states in no uncertain terms what is expected of his fighting forces and of his engineering organizations.
Hitler demands the construction of a 5,000-kilometer defensive barrier, nearly twice the length of America's east coast. Giant gun batteries and bunkers capable of smashing any Allied invasion by sea. The job of building them falls to one man.
Hitler. Hitler.
Attention.
These are the Führer's latest orders. The coast must be armed with as many heavy guns as possible.
Franz Xaver Dorsch is a chief engineer of the TOT organization, Germany's biggest engineering company.
These guns are to be enclosed in concrete.
Dorsch and his colleagues are experts in large-scale construction. They pioneered Nazi Germany's famous autobahns, thousands of kilometers of roads that still exist today.
I will personally direct the work. Is that all clear?
Dorsch has already built 20 heavy gun emplacements at Calais, the closest French port to Britain, and the most likely site for any Allied invasion. These giant bunkers, each requiring over 40,000 tons of concrete, will provide the template for Hitler's planned wall. Incredibly, many still survive today.
Visiting these bunkers, it's like a step back into time.
Arthur van Beveren is an expert in the Atlantic Wall and has been exploring its ruins since he was a boy.
These walls are 3.5 meters thick, and if you look at this corner, you can still see the shape of the wood in the concrete. It left its marks in the concrete while it was being poured. The huge dome-like building is the actual gun emplacement, which the 38-centimeter gun was beneath. On this side, we have the crew rooms, kitchens, first aid, and ammunition. Very atmospheric place back then. And I think it still is.
The shells are 1.6 meters long and weigh over 800 kilograms. They're so big that they have to be moved inside on a system of overhead rails.
So you can see the rail from the outside going through this gap up here, but you can still see part left in this gap, and it was used to transport the ammunition. This is now just an empty gap, but 70 years ago there should be a door up here, and it was a table up here. The ammunition was prepared, laying on the table, and on this side there was a little train driving along the gun. And the ammunition was put on the little train and transported to the gun.
The giant guns of the Calais battery are capable of sinking the largest Allied ships in an invasion fleet, even before they've left port.
From here, on a clear day, you can see Britain on the other side of the channel. Britain is only 36 kilometers away, and these guns could reach 30 kilometers inside Britain.
Now, Dorsch and his team of engineers set about building a series of similar emplacements and fortifications around strategic Atlantic ports. Newsreels in Berlin proudly boast of their awesome firepower. And no one is following progress more avidly than 16-year-old Franz Gockel.
In kürzester Zeit ist alles gefechtsbereit.
I'd seen so much reported about the wall in the newsreel that I was sure we'd be invincible.
Hier zeigt Deutschland im vierten Jahr des Krieges die gigantische Stärke seiner Abwehrkraft. Der deutsche Soldat.
Soon, Gockel will see the Atlantic Wall firsthand, on D-Day itself. Throughout 1942, construction of the Atlantic Wall is stepped up, even as far north as Norway. Massive amounts of men and resources are sent to defend the coast, all the way to the Arctic.
Norway was very important initially because of its location. There's a lot of iron ore coming out of Sweden, and it's taken aboard ship in Norwegian ports.
Iron ore is vital to the German war effort, providing the steel in Hitler's bombs, tanks, and bunkers. the Norwegian supply line must be defended. One extreme solution? Move a 900-ton naval gun turret to Åland to protect the port of Trondheim. Astonishingly, it still survives to this day.
Essentially, this is a ship built on land, built inside this mountain. A deep shaft, 5 levels deep, was cut into the mountain and was filled up with concrete, and the turret was placed inside that shaft.
The occupying German forces in Norway used prisoners of war to dig an 11-meter deep hole through the solid rock. It has to be lined with concrete before the turret can be rebuilt inside.
The guns were put in parts, 80 trainloads of parts went to Trondheim, and from Trondheim onto boats up to the island. The 3 guns are the only thing you can see on the outside, but the actual bunker is inside this mountain. When you look around it, it's like solid engineering everywhere. It's all separate pieces working together to make this machine going, like a monster, really. The black floor we see here is the actual tower from the ship. This part is really the bunker, the shaft into the mountain. This part will stand still. So this is concrete, and this is a 5-floor-deep shaft from a naval ship.
Just as when it was on a ship, the massive gun needs to rotate.
The whole turret is resting on these ball bearings all around us. Oh, really very heavy, really very heavy. I guess about 40, 50 kilos. And they're all around, resting in the rail around the shaft.
138 steel balls carry the weight of the 900-ton gun and allow it to turn smoothly. The shell and propellant are stored 5 levels below the gun.
We got 3 different kinds of ammunition here. We got high explosive shells, armored piercing shells, and even shells with time fuse.
To maneuver these 300 kilogram shells, the Nazi engineers devise an ingenious hydraulic lift system.
The shells will come right out of the walls, the ammunition rooms, slide over here, roll on to this table, roll on further on this one, and when it finally reaches it up here, you could traverse the shell up to the lift. Of course, normally it would be hydraulically operated.
The ammunition is lifted 5 stories up to barrel level, ready to be fired.
The effective range of these guns was about 37 kilometers, and that's as far as the eye can see, from the top from Norway all the way down to the south of France, you can find the same kind of bunkers. So it's not just concrete blocks, it's massive ships on land.
Alongside the heavily defended batteries at the ports of Movik, Cherbourg, Brest, and the island of Jersey, a formidable display of defense is taking shape. But Hitler realizes this is still not enough. Between the ports, vast stretches of coast remain undefended.
Hitler puts out another order that 15,000 bunkers are to be built along a coastline stretching 3,000 miles, and they are to be manned by 300,000 troops.
Hitler wants every meter of the 5,000-kilometer Atlantic coast defended by a continuous line of fortifications. And he wants it finished by May 1943, in just 7 months' time.
Speer describes Hitler spending his evenings designing concrete bunkers. and he had locked in his desk a series of maps of the Western seaboard at which he would plot where fortifications would be.
The wall now becomes his obsession.
These designs ideally meet all the requirements of a frontline soldier. During this winter, with fanatical zeal, a fortress must be built, which will hold in all circumstances.
Heil Hitler.
Sogar der Chef der Garage-Taverne glaubt nicht.
The task of making Hitler's wall a reality falls to his chief engineer, Dorsch.
That is the absolute maximum volume of construction we can handle. We cannot handle anymore.
Dorsch might have concerns, but nobody refuses the Führer. Construction teams try and meet Hitler's demands, focusing their efforts on areas where they think the invasion might come, such as the beaches of Vissand, closest to the British mainland.
We're now standing on top of an anti-tank bunker. It was built here in March 1943, and it's the type 631. And the Germans designed about 500 different types of bunkers. The Atlantic Wall was not one line of bunkers, but it was made out of several strong points with open spaces in between.
With the British Air Force in control of the skies, the 475 soldiers here live in constant fear of attacks. When an invasion comes, large tanks will roll up this beach. And this bunker houses the gun that can stop them.
We're now in the most important room of this bunker, because this is the room where the gun used to be. The anti-tank gun, 4.7 centimeters, from Czech origin.
The men stationed here spent months preparing for an invasion. The firing range for every potential target was carefully practiced.
This is a really cool feature in this bunker. It actually still has these numbers on the plate next to the gun. And they tell the crew certain points in the landscape how far they are away from the bunker. We have a church or a house near the beach, so they can measure from these points how to aim the gun.
The bunker was designed to be indestructible, but there's still the risk of being buried alive by the debris of a battle.
We have another exit here. It's the escape shaft. You have to get through the brick wall. You have to dig through 4 meters of pebbles, and then you can get out via this shaft on the side of the bunker.
Walking through one of these structures today, I might as well be walking through Stonehenge, because these are very enigmatic structures. But if you were to see them operating, with all the hardware, all of the guns and the men inside them, I think you'd be fairly impressed at what these things have developed into. Very, very frightening fighting machines.
Only 30% of the required bunkers are finished by Hitler's deadline of May 1943. As chief engineer, Zaber Dorsch knows Hitler will blame him.
We have handed over 9,671 ready-to-occupy bunkers. And the concrete work has been done for another 1,500.
But Dorsch lacks the resources that he needs to increase production. The war has now dragged on for 4 years, and the Germans are running out of material, money, and men.
Hitler gets very irritated when resources keep bleeding away from the Western seaboard, from his Atlantic wall, to the war in the East. He puts out an edict and says, nobody moves anything or anyone from the Atlantic wall without my prior and direct permission.
October 1943. Colville, Normandy. New conscript Private Franz Gockel, just 17, arrives at his section of the wall. The propaganda films that he's watched back in Germany spoke of giant fortresses and gun positions. But he's in for a shock.
Imagine my surprise arriving at the beach in Normandy. There weren't any protective bunkers.
Hitler believes the Allied invasion will land at Calais, the closest French port to Great Britain. That's where his Atlantic wall is at its strongest. Few eyes are on the beaches of Normandy. Franz Gockel's diary records happy days spent swimming and playing near the beach at Colville, a stretch of sand that will come to be known as Omaha Beach.
France is a beautiful country, and I see the sea every day. I don't really have that much to do.
It was definitely a cushy life compared to the horrors of the Eastern Front. The men here felt very happy that they were here in France.
November 1943. Events in Russia are going from bad to worse. The Germans have been forced into retreat by a powerful Soviet army.
The Germans lost on average 2,000 men killed in action each day, and that since June 1941.
Hitler and his generals now face a crisis. They have to fight on two fronts. Millions of their soldiers tied up in the east, and 5,000 kilometers of coastline to defend in the west. The Nazis have posted 300,000 soldiers to the bunkers of the Atlantic Wall, but they are inexperienced troops.
The crew here of the bunkers were mainly young soldiers, 17 or 18 years old, or older family fathers in their late 30s. The guys in the early 20s, mid-20s, the best soldier material, as you would call it in military terms, were mainly on the Eastern Front.
The Nazi high command are counting on millions of tons of concrete and steel to make the difference and keep the Allies at bay.
You can say that the bunkers made the soldiers better fighters. You could be a bit overweight, you could be a bit overaged, but you could still pull the trigger on a machine gun.
Bunkers might compensate for the problem of inexperienced troops. But on average, there are still only 100 German soldiers to defend each kilometer of coast. And only 50% of Hitler's impregnable wall has been completed.
This is hopeless. I am the greatest builder of fortifications of all time. And this is all I get.
By November 1943, Hitler runs out of patience with the slow progress of war construction. He appoints a new commander to take charge. A man whose legendary toughness in battle might make up for the weaknesses of the wall. Field Marshal Erwin Rommel.
Quick, fall in!
Rommel immediately sets about inspecting the entire length of the Atlantic Wall. He's been fighting the Allies in North Africa for 2 years. Rommel is a master of attack and defense. What he sees in Normandy shocks him.
Rommel came to this place here in January 1944, and when he looked at the conditions and how the defense preparations had gone, he was very upset. He was saying, "You've been here for 3 years, and what have you done? Nothing."
German planners believe that the Allies are unlikely to choose it as an invasion site because it lacks a port. So few bunkers have been built here. But Rommel sees something they can't.
This beach looks similar to the Bay of Salerno in Italy that the Allies invaded. It must be instantly secured against Allied landings. If the British once get a foothold on dry land, they can't be thrown out again.
Rommel knows this beach needs to be defended. If the Allies land here, the Nazis could lose the war. He's right to be concerned. Across the channel, 150,000 Allied troops are massing in secret. The Atlantic Wall is about to face the ultimate test. And at Omaha Beach, Franz Goeckel will face the full onslaught of the invasion. By January 1944, Soviet Russia is still pushing the Nazis back in the east. And in the west, Hitler's Atlantic Wall is far from complete. Field Marshal Rommel faces an enormous challenge to improve the quality of the defenses, as he records in his diary.
These fortifications are the work of an engineer who is neither strategically proficient nor has any knowledge of war.
Rommel's experience fighting the Allies has taught him that holding off an invasion will require meticulous planning. And he has a very clear strategy.
Rommel believes that an enemy invasion has to be smashed, if not at sea, on the beach. If the enemy get off the beach, he thinks the game is over.
To defend every beach, Rommel wants thousands more small bunkers for individual soldiers, armed with heavy machine guns. They will be quicker to build, but there's still the problem of manpower.
As the war develops, they don't have the spare manpower within Germany, and they basically draft in the people of these countries, the Poles, the Czechs, you name it, the French, people from concentration camps, Allied prisoners of war, all of which is massively inhumane. Thousands and thousands of them die in these construction projects and through bad diet and bad treatment, and it just becomes slave labor. No!
Ah! 32,000 civilians are forced into construction, a brutal but effective plan. Bunkers are being constructed along almost 5,000 kilometers of Nazi coast, clustered in groups known as WNs.
A WN is a Widerstandsnest, which translates into English into a resistance nest. You can say it is more or less a strong point, but a series of strong points interconnected.
In Normandy, Goeckel and 30 of his comrades live in a strong point that still exists today.
We can see here the small room was probably for the NCOs. Here is the accommodation block for the other ranks. Amongst them was also this 18-year-old Franz Goeckel. But of course, the soldiers did not stay here all the time. They were on guard, they had to build up the constructions, there was general military training.
Goeckel's strong point is at the east end of a Normandy shoreline that will become infamous. Omaha Beach. To defend it, they have 13 gun positions, including two anti-tank guns and three mortars. The guns work in pairs, targeting the beach with deadly arcs of crossfire. This tactic creates an area of maximum firepower, known as a killing zone.
The killing zone is basically the area where the enemy is going to bring the maximum effect from all their weapon systems in the most condensed space to inflict the maximum amount of casualties on the enemy, in this case, the Allies. What you've got over here is two positions. They've got machine guns, mortars, and over here, another position, machine guns, mortars, some larger caliber rounds as well. And the reason this box is here is because the Allies are trying to get up that draw and off the beach.
Defending this stretch of Omaha Beach is vital for the Germans to throw back an Allied invasion. Gockel's job is to man a machine gun, and his position covers this kill zone.
This is Gockel's position. Today, it's only a hole in the ground. Back in 1944, it had a machine gun, it was a covered position, and also had two switches for a flamethrower.
Gockel's bunker is finished by May 1944, along with thousands more that protect the coast from Norway to the Spanish border. But Rommel still isn't satisfied. The bunkers alone are not enough. He also wants other types of defensive structure to help repel an Allied invasion.
What Rommel does, he uses the experiences he's gained in North Africa to bring about dramatic changes. And one of those involves the laying of massive minefields.
He orders the laying of 50 million mines along the French coast, at sea and on the beach. And in addition, he wants the beaches filled with obstacles, row after row littering the beach, to create impenetrable layers of defense. The first line by the low tide mark are steel barriers known as Belgian gates.
You've got Belgian gates put along here. And the idea behind these Belgian gates is to block the landing craft, infantry and tanks and basically hold them as far back down the beach as they can.
Belgian gates create a barrier to slow down infantry and tanks, giving the Germans more time to kill them. In case the Allies arrive at high tide and sail over the Belgian gates, Rommel devises another surprise.
Right here is where they have the ram logs. Think about telegraph poles cut, raising above my head, 30 degree angle, a couple of other ones supporting it down here. At the end of these, you're going to have basically like saw blades, which are there to take, rip the bottom out of the landing craft if the Allies come in at high tide.
But even that's not enough. The Germans use absolutely anything that might disrupt and delay the landing force.
Here you have the third belt, and this is what they call Czech hedgehogs. They are basically steel structures set at angles like this, and basically to disrupt anyone that's coming up the beaches.
And if the landing craft finally make it onto the beach, these are the last line of defense to stop Allied tanks in their tracks.
So this is a steel-encrusted concrete tetrahedra, and this is one of the last obstacles under the obstacle plan for defending the beaches. You can imagine if there'd be a whole load of these all across the breach, interlinked at, you know, every 5 meters and 5 meters. Tank's going to struggle against this, you know? It's so sturdy. It's going to turn the tank. Which way is the track's going to go? Especially thin track tanks slip off the side, you know?
By June 1944, Rommel is still trying to complete German defenses along the Atlantic coast. Meanwhile, across the channel, the Allied troops are ready. Hitler's Atlantic Wall has cost billions of Reichmarks and consumed millions of tons of concrete, but it's still riddled with holes.
Rommel promised Hitler that he would have finished everything by May 1944, but it was still incomplete. So many of the bunkers on the Atlantic Wall were lacking guns, or were lacking men, or were lacking barbed wire or minefields.
The 5th of June. Gockel spends the day patrolling the cliffs above Omaha Beach. Unknown to him, just over the horizon, thousands of British, Canadian, and American troops have put out to sea to start an invasion.
At 2 o'clock in the morning on the 6th of June, the 7th Army gave the alert level 2. This was the highest alert level in the German Army. And immediately, the men from the artillery regiment, and in this case from the 1st Company, moved into their positions here at WN62.
Where's the line? up! Get up! Get up! This is for real! The Americans are parachuting in, just 30 kilometers away!
There was an alarm call, but none of us believed it. We'd had so many in the past weeks that we no longer took it seriously.
You too, Gokul! Get out!
We ran to our positions. Machine guns, heavy guns, and mortars were prepared.
Gokul and his comrades believed the invasion would come at a major port, like Calais. Never did they imagine that it would happen here, at their beach.
Has Gokul got ammunition? Well, go, check!
Hitler and a lot of others were fairly convinced that it would have to be a major port, because they would have to get their material ashore. Little did they know that the Allies had countered that. They'd come up with the Mulberry Harbours.
The Allies invent an ingenious way of avoiding the heavily fortified ports. They build the world's first floating harbour, known as the Mulberry Harbour, and tow it to Normandy.
Gokul, do you need ammunition?
Yes.
Good luck.
I tried to concentrate on my weapon, to take my mind off what was happening.
Pass auf, sie kommen!
Normally a German machine gun should be manned by two soldiers. Here we had only one man per machine gun.
Allied battleships begin a full-scale bombardment of the German positions. Gokul's survival now rests on whether the reinforced concrete of his bunker is tough enough.
Heavy caliber shells continue to slam into the earth, howling and hissing through the air. They hit against the concrete and ground with a thud.
Gokul's bunker withstands the onslaught, but this is just the beginning. When the Allied forces land, they're met with a hail of machine gun fire. Just 500 Germans have to defend a 6-kilometer beach against 35,000 Americans. The ultimate test of the Atlantic War has begun.
The Germans are firing with each weapon they've got available here, with their flamethrowers, with their machine guns, with their field guns, with their artillery from further inland. This was when German firepower was the biggest.
Omaha is just one of five invasion beaches. 150,000 American, Canadian, and British troops are landing along the Normandy coast, and the enormous Atlantic War is beginning to crack. 160 kilometers away, the German armored reserve of tanks are waiting. If they're called up to plug the gaps, there's still a chance that the Allies can be thrown back. But there's a problem.
Hitler was asleep, and no one dared to wake him up. And this was crucial because Hitler was the person who could release the armored reserves. And when he woke up, he still didn't believe it was a full invasion.
The tanks remain far inland. And the only other man who can make a difference is even further away, in Germany, celebrating his wife's birthday.
Rommel said the first 24 hours are crucial to defeat the Allied invasion. And on the 6th of June, he was not here. And it was only in the late afternoon that Rommel rushed back from Germany and arrived in France to coordinate the defense measures. But by that time, the Allies had already a firm grip on the beaches here.
At 9 a.m., 7 hours after the first shots are fired, the bunker next to Gokul's position is destroyed. His machine gun is the last one still firing from his group of bunkers.
Sand caused the belt of my machine gun to jam. I had to continue using my rifle, firing single shots.
Amazingly, the Germans are holding back the Americans. But despite the months of preparation, they're running low on ammunition.
The Germans were supposed to have ammunition for 48 hours on the Atlantic Wall. In reality, they had only in this section only ammunition for 3.5 hours. So at 10 o'clock, the Germans were starting to run out of ammunition.
As their supply of bullets is depleted, the Germans begin to struggle, and the Americans gain ground. Gockel and his comrades are forced to fall back.
Making my way up a slope, I crawled to the top to reach my comrades. I saw three fingers on my left hand dangling by the threads.
Now wounded, Gockel retreats with the few survivors of his company. Omaha is the last of the five invasion beaches to fall. The vast Atlantic Wall has taken 3 years to build, but is breached in a matter of hours. The Germans lose the battle and will soon lose the war.
Despite all the costs, millions of Reichsmark and millions of cubic meters of concrete built into these structures, the Atlantic Wall could not hold the Allied invasion force.
The Atlantic Wall doesn't work for a number of reasons. It's stretched too far, there are too many gaps in it. The basic policy behind it is flawed. The Germans never come up with a grand plan of how to fight this machine they've built, how they're going to take it into war.
Despite the wall's failure, Czar Dorsch remained head of the Tote organization until Germany's surrender. After the war, he had a successful engineering career until his death, aged 86. Rommel was forced to commit suicide by Hitler just 4 months after D-Day. Franz Gockel survived the war, returning to Germany where he married and lived until the age of 80. He came back to Normandy several times to remember the men who died for and against the wall.
I think D-Day is probably the most important event in Europe to have occurred perhaps over the last 500 years. To kick Nazi Germany back into touch and to take back control for civilization. I think it's an absolutely astounding event. And it works because the Allies got their act together and the Germans never did. It's as simple as that.